Hello students, today's lecture is a continuation of our last lecture, that is we are now presently studying the type study, that is a type study on the prawns. Okay, prawns belong to the phylum Arthropoda, class Crustacea. Okay, so in our last lecture we have already dealt with the systematic position with a brief introduction and the types of appendages or the typical pattern of appendages in the prawns. Okay, in the today's lecture we will study about the body wall, body cavity, circulatory system, respiratory system and the digestive system in the prawns. Okay, so we'll start with the body wall. The body wall of the prawns is consist of three layers, that is they are triploblastic in nature, consist of three germ layers, that is a namely called as a cuticle, epidermis and dermis. Okay, the cuticle is the outermost layer of the body and it consists of further two layers, namely an outer epicuticle and inner endocuticle. Okay, and this epicuticle is a non chitinous layer and it is made out of lipoid layer. Okay, it is non chitinous layer and it is further made of two layers. First layer, that is outer layer, will be lipid layer, that is lipoid layer, and an inner layer will be a protein layer. Okay, that is it is consist of protein and the outermost layer will be consist of lipids. Okay, then the next one is the endocuticle. Endocuticle lies to the inner side of the cuticle and it is chitinous in nature. Okay, that is it is consists or composed of polyglucosamine. Okay, the chitin which is called as a polyglucosamine and it is secreted by the epidermis. Okay, epidermis is the next is the after cuticle comes the epidermis. The epidermis is formed of single layer of a columnar cell. Okay, and these cells are resting on the basement membrane and it secretes the chitin. Okay, and then third layer is the dermis. Dermis is the innermost layer of the body wall and it is made up of thin layer of a connective tissues. Okay, and this dermis contain tegmental glands which is secreted by the epicuticle layer of the cuticle. Okay, then we'll see the body cavity. During general characteristics of the arthropod we have already studied that the body cavity of the arthropods is hemocoelomic. Okay, that is the true coelom is not present. Okay, what is body cavity or the coelom? A coelom or the body cavity is the space between the body wall and the alimentary canal. Okay, so here they lack true coelom. Okay, and that's why here the coelomic or the body cavity is called as a hemocoel. And it is filled with the blood-like fluid called as a hemocoelomic fluid. Okay, and this hemocoelomic fluid contains corpuscles like those present in our blood. Okay, and this hemocoel is derived from the embryonic blastocoel. The origin of this hemocoel is from the embryonic blastocoel. Okay, and in a hemocoel what happens, the true coelom is represented by small cavities that are located around reproductive organs, that is the gonads and the kidney. Okay, the next point is circulatory system or next characteristic. The circulatory system is open type, so there is no capillaries, hence the blood is flow out of the blood vessels and it is collected in an open space called as a sinuses. Okay, and the circulatory system in prawns is consist of blood, heart, pericardium, arteries, blood sinuses and blood channels. Okay, and first we'll see blood. The blood of prawn is in blue color. Okay, it is liquid tissue and it will contain a plasma and corpuscles. Okay, and this plasma contains a blue pigment called as a hemocyanin. During our general characteristic, I have already told you that blood will be in the form of hemocyanin, which is in blue in color when it is get oxygenated, and corpuscles are colorless when it is deoxygenated. It becomes colorless. Okay, then next part of the circulatory system is the heart. Okay, here the picture of heart is there. Okay, the heart of this prawns is muscular. Okay, and it is a muscular pumping organ that is located in the thorax. It is triangular in shape, and at the apex it is directed forward, and this heart is found in a fibrous tissue strands. Okay, this heart has a perforated pores or ostia called as a opening called as a ostia, and it will be having in a 5 pairs. Okay, which is slit like. So the heart of prawns is a muscular in nature, triangular in shape, and it is directed, the apex is directed forward. Okay, it is found in a or located in a thoracic region, thorax, and this heart is held in a by a fibrous tissue strands. The heart of prawns is perforated by a 5 pairs of ostia, okay, which is slit like, and the blood will flow into heart through this ostia. Okay, and from the blood from the heart is carried out by the arteries. Okay, and these arteries will be from the anterior to the posterior end, will run from the anterior to the posterior end. Then next is the pericardium. The next part is the pericardium. And the heart is surrounded by a space cavity called as a pericardium or dorsal sinus. Okay, and this space is filled with the blood, and there will be giving rise to the pericardial sinus that will receive blood through a 6 pair of afferent branchial channel. Okay, and this blood from the pericardial sinus enter the heart through the ostia. Okay, so pericardium is the space or cavity that is formed surrounds the heart. This pericardium also called as a dorsal sinus, and it is filled with the blood, and from the afferent branchial channel this pericardial will receive blood. Okay, and this blood is from the pericardial enters to the sinus, from the sinus enters to the heart, and through heart in heart by the ostia that is present on the heart or slits. Okay, then next part on next content of circulatory system is the arteries. Arteries will carry blood from the heart to the various part of the organs, and these organs in the organs they will branches into small vessels, okay, which opens into the sinuses. Okay, and based on that there are like different arteries are present. In this picture we can see different arteries are present, that is ophthalmic arteries, then antenary arteries, hepatic arteries, steno-intestinal arteries. Okay, the first one is the ophthalmic arteries. In between you can see the ophthalmic, the broad one is the ophthalmic artery. Okay, it starts from the apex of the heart anteriorly, and it runs forward towards the head and joined with the circumcephalus. It joins to the circumcephalicus arteries. Okay, then comes the antenary arteries. Antenary arteries, here two antenary arteries arises from the apex of the heart and one on either side of the ophthalmic arteries that forms the like a balloon like shape. You can see the arteries which encircles the ophthalmic arteries at the anterior side. Okay, that is runs towards the left hand side of my of the screen. It forms a bulges like balloon like. It is the antennary arteries. It is two in number, and it will run from the apex of the heart from the anterior to the each side of each from the each side encircling the ophthalmic arteries. Okay, and the anterior end of the head, each anterior artery divide into two branches. Okay, namely dorsal branch and ventral branch. Okay, the dorsal branch of the two antennary arteries meet anteriorly to form a circumcephalous artery. Okay, and this circumcephalous receives the ophthalmic arteries and give out a pair of optic arteries. Okay, that will give out a pair of optic arteries and a pair of rostral arteries. Optic will go for the eyes, whereas the rostral will go to the rostrum. Okay, the ventral branch further divide into three arteries, namely antennular arteries to the that gives to the antennules or antenna, then antennal artery to the antenna, and the renal artery to the renal region. Okay, then even further, like this antennary arteries give three branches on each side, namely pericardial artery and a gastric artery and the mandibular artery. So at the opposite, like in between, at each side near the heart, it will give rise to the anterior part of the heart. It gives rise to the pericardial artery, a gastric artery, and mandibular arteries. Mandibular artery will be passed to the mandibles, whereas gastric to the gastric glands, whereas the pericardial to the pericardium. Okay, then comes the hepatic arteries. A pair of hepatic arteries arises from the anterior of the heart. They are situated on either side of antennary arteries. They supply hepatopancreas. Okay, then the they supply to the hepatopancreas. Then steno-intestinal artery. This steno-intestinal arteries will originate from the posterior of the heart. Okay, and it will run immediately divides into two branches, namely supra-intestinal artery and ventral abdominal artery. Supra-intestinal artery and it will be sternal artery. Okay, supra-intestinal artery one thing, and another one will be sternal artery. The supra-intestinal artery runs backward along the dorsal surface of the intestine, and it supplies blood to the meat gut. Okay, whereas the sternal artery runs downward and forward and pass through the thoracic ganglionic mass to reach the ventral side, and it divides into two branches, namely ventral thoracic artery and ventral abdominal arteries. Okay, and this ventral thoracic arteries runs forward and supplies blood to the thoracic sternum and thoracic appendages, whereas the ventral abdominal arteries runs backward and supplies blood to the abdominal sternum and abdominal appendages. Okay, then next part is the blood sinus. Blood sinus in the arteries divides and redivide into small branches, and it finally give rise or open into the space called as a blood sinus. Here it is the small sinus that join a large sinuses, and they are two large sinuses located on a ventral side. They are called ventral or sternal sinus, and they are located in the thoracic region or below the hepatopancreas, and they are interconnected. Okay, whereas next one is the blood channels. Blood channels are lacunar tubes in the form of lacunar tube that is without proper wall, carrying blood from the sinus to the pericardium through the gills. Okay, and here the 6 efferent branchial channels carry venous blood from the each ventral sinus to the gills of the site, and in the gills the blood is aerated, that is oxygen is added. Okay, and the aerated blood is transported from the gills of each side to the pericardium through another 6 efferent branchial channels. Okay, then we'll see the course of blood circulation. The heart pumps the blood by its rhythmic contraction, and then the blood enters the arteries and supplies the various part of the organs. Okay, from the organs the blood is collected in the ventral sinuses. From the ventral sinus the blood is carried by the efferent branchial channel to the gills and the efferent for aeration, and the aerated blood is carried to the pericardium through the efferent branchial channel. Okay, and from the pericardium the blood flows into the heart through the ostium. Okay, so this is the flowchart how the blood circulation take place. First heart pumps the blood and arteries carries the blood from to the blood sinuses, then from the blood sinuses efferent and efferent branchial channels carry the blood to the gills, and from gills efferent branchial channels to the pericardial sinuses. Okay, then next characteristic feature, then next one is the respiratory system. Respiratory system in prawns consists of or they show aquatic mode of respiration, that it is carried out by the organs called as the branchiostegite, epipodites and gills. Okay, this branchiostegite is a gill cover and it is the lateral extension of of the carapace. Okay, and it closes a cavity between itself and the body and this carrying is called as gill chamber. This cavity is called as gill chamber. So once again we repeat, branchiostegite is the gill cover and it covers the larynx. It covers the lateral extension of the carapace. In the picture you can see branchiostegite. Okay, and it encloses a cavity between itself and body, and this cavity is called as a gill chamber. Okay, and the inner lining of the branchiostegite is richly supplied with the blood, and it constantly bathed by the water currents. Okay, and hence exchange of gases occurs between the between the water and the blood. Okay, then next respiratory organ or system that was observed is epipodite. During the typical appendages discussion we have studied about the epipodite. This epipodite is a membranous outgrowth of the integument arising from the coxa of the thoracic appendages, and in this Prons, that is pineal, has a 6 pairs of epipodide, and they are located on the first 6 pairs of thoracic appendages. And the first pair of the epipodide are conical in shape, whereas the remaining 5 are in the wide shaped. Okay, and they are highly vascular, and they exchange gases between the blood and the water. Okay. And last one is the respiratory system consists of gills. The gills are delicate. Here in this prompt, the gills are delicate feather-like outgrowth of the thoracic appendages, and these gills are located inside the gill chamber, and the gill chamber is located on the side of the thoracic, and it is covered by the branchiostegite. And these gills are increasing in size backward. So the first gill is the smallest, whereas the last gill is the largest. The gills are crescent shape. Each gill has central axis and numerous branched gills. Filaments on the branched gill filament on both sides, okay, and this type of gill is called as a dendrobranch. Okay, and the number and the arrangement of gills in prawns are given in the formula, okay, that is called as a branchial formula. And the gills of pineus is further classified into 3 types. Okay, that is based on their place of attachment, that is podobranchus, pleobranchus and arthrobranchus. This podobranchus, also called as the foot gills, are attached to the gills at the coxa of the appendages. Penis here in prawns has 1 pair of podobranchus, which is attached to second maxillary pits, whereas pleurobranchus is the side gills, and these are gills which are attached to the lateral wall of the thorax, and here they are in 6 pairs of pleurobranchus, which are which are attached near the last 6 pairs of the thoracic appendages. Okay, then next one comes the arthrobranchus, that is the joint gills. Okay, these are the gills which are attached to the junction of the appendages and the body. Okay, and they are 11 pairs of there are 11 pairs of arthrobranchus gills in the prawns. And this gills receives blood. This gills received blood from the junction of appendages and body, and they are 11 in arthropods. And the gills receives blood through the efferent branchial channel, and the oxygenated blood is carried away by the efferent branchial channels to the peculum. To the pericardial sinus, that is pericardial sinus. Okay, then with this we have completed the this respiratory system in prawns. Next we will going to see about the digestive system. The digestive system of the prawns consists of alimentary canal and the digestive gland. Okay, so alimentary canal is further divided into foregut, midgut and the hindgut. Okay, and the foregut is formed of mouth, buccal cavity and esophagus and stomach. Okay, and the foregut and the hindgut is lined by the chitin. Okay, so once again we'll revise that the alimentary canal consists of foregut, midgut and hindgut. Foregut consists of mouth, buccal cavity, esophagus and stomach. Okay, so we'll see that the mouth lies in between the mandibles. Okay, and it leads to the buccal cavity. Mouth wheel leads to the buccal cavity. Buccal cavity is followed by esophagus, which is a short and runs vertically from the buccal cavity to the stomach. Okay, and the stomach consists of large cardiac stomach, and at the posterior there is a small pyloric stomach. Okay, so two stomach, large cardiac stomach and a small pyloric stomach. The floor of the cardiac stomach has a many folds. Okay, so what happens? They will bear a CTA and the spicule, whereas the roof of the cardiac stomach has many calcareous stout denticles, which constitute the gastric meal or the gastric armature. Okay, whereas the dactyls are called as a gastric meal because they are used in grinding food. Here the denticles which are present is called as a gastric meal because they are also used in grinding the food. Next is the pyloric stomach. Pyloric stomach has a narrow lumen and it is followed by the midgut. Okay, then the midgut will be extended as a straight tube up to the sixth abdominal segment. The chitinous lining of the pyloric stomach is produced into the midgut as the four lipids or the valvulae. Okay, whereas the hindgut or the rectum follows the midgut, and the hindgut is very short. It opens to the exteriorly by the anus. Okay, and then comes the digestive gland. Digestive gland of the prawns is basically surrounded by a large gland called as a hepatopancreas. Okay, and it is formed of numerous tubules. The tubules joins from two large ducts called as a hepatopancreatic ducts, and they will open into the pyloric stomach. Okay, and this hepatopancreas does not function this hepatopancreas will function or play a role like liver, pancreas and intestine, which are the role which is performed by the liver, pancreas and intestine of the human beings or higher animals. Similarly, this hepatopancreatic gland will perform the similar function. Okay, and function is to secrete the digestive enzyme. That is, for example, pancreas is secreted by the hepatopancreas. Okay, it also performs the function of storing the glycogen, fat and calcium. And the third function is to intracellular digestion of absorbing food from the stomach. Okay, so this digestive gland will carry out three important functions. That is the secretion of digestive enzyme called as a pancreas. Then second is it will act as a storage for glycogen, fat and calcium, and it will also exhibits intracellular digestion by absorbing food from the stomach. Okay, then feeding habits of the prawns. Prawns or the penis is an omnivorous animal, that it will feed on plants, small crustaceans, small fishes, algae. Okay, so what happens? The chelate leg. Okay, that is the first three legs. Chelate leg. Remember, what are the first three walking legs or the thoracic leg? Chelate leg are the first three pair of walking leg is called as the chelate leg. So this chelate leg and the third maxillipid will help in capturing and conveying the food into the mouth. okay, and the then comes the mandibles. Mandible will cut the this food material into smaller pieces. Then the food is further ground in the gastric meal and digested in the stomach. Okay, and the digested food is absorbed by the meat gut, and undigested food material are passed through the anus. Okay, with this we are ending up with our lecture. In today's lecture we have dealt with the body cavity, body wall, alimentary canal, respiratory system and circulatory system. If any question or doubts are there, then please let me know. Okay, and thank you.